excited. Come, Holy Spirit. All right. So welcome everyone to Behind the Veil, the second one that we have done so far. We're so happy you're here. We want to start with a very short prayer for everyone to get into the frame of mind of taking all of this in. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day and all of our blessings. Holy Spirit, we invite you into this space, into our hearts and into our minds to discern. Help us to discern. Blessed Mother, we know you want holy vocations. Please pray for us. We ask all of this in your Son's name. Amen. Our Lady of Guadalupe, pray for us. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. So I am Rhonda Grunewald, founder of Vocation Ministry. I'm a married woman. And Dawn Hausman is here with us as well. She is a consecrated virgin and director of consecrated life for the Diocese of Lansing, Michigan. This is a joint venture between the Diocese of Lansing and Vocation Ministry. And we have Elizabeth Cantu, who is also a married woman. She works for Vocation Ministry. She'll be in the chats with you. And as well as some of the sisters will be chatting with you too. But just in case you see Elizabeth Cantu chatting, you know who she is. Dawn is going to be leading the Q&As at the end of each hour. We are excited that you're here, and I want you to know that each hour is going to have a totally different flavor because you have totally different sisters running each hour. So if the first hour is going to be amazing, it is. But if it's not exactly what you expected, hold on to your seats. The next one will be, or maybe. So just know that each hour is going to be different. And the discerners hour at the end, at the last hour, is for discerners only. And it is going to be amazing with two breakout sessions with the sisters. And you get to pick which sisters to be in the room with. So you do not want to miss that. Please feel free to come and go throughout the day. We know some of you have to do that, and that's okay. We'll be giving you time for reflection and prayer in between each time, as well as a little restroom break. So before we get too much farther, let us go ahead and introduce the SALT Sisters, the Society of Our Lady of the Most Holy Trinity. We are so excited that you are with us today. It's Sister Kateri, Sister Caritas, and the novices of the SALT Sisters. So thank you so much for being here. Sister Kateri, take it away.
Well, I just want to welcome all of you and happy Feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe. We've just celebrated at our parish here. I'm assigned in Detroit, Michigan. So we just have been celebrating all morning because we serve in a Hispanic parish. So just to give that also happy solemnity, Feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe to all of you. So a little bit about SALT. We're a missionary community, and our community serves priests, sisters, and lay faithful serve together. So at our mission here in Detroit, I serve with, I live with five other sisters, and we also serve with our priests. There's four priests here, and then we have brothers. So we have seven brothers that are also assigned here in Detroit. And all of our missions are a little different. Our apostolate here for the sisters is in Detroit, is really working at our school. So we serve at Holy Redeemer Catholic School, and I myself am the principal at the school. And then there's two sisters that teach, and they're teaching middle school. And then we have one sister that helps in the kindergarten room, and then another sister who's taking classes and is going to grad school for counseling. So all of our missions are a little different. So ours here really is focusing serving the parish by serving the parochial school. I want to introduce Sister Caritas and have her just share a little bit about her convent and what they do there, and then we'll have the novices introduce themselves.
Hi, y'all. So I'm Sister Caritas, and I am in Corpus Christi, Texas, and my assignment is kind of multifaceted. I work at the parish. So just like Sister Kateri, we had Las Mañanitas this morning, Menudo, We sang to Our Lady. We had Our Lady of Guadalupe celebration, which was awesome. So it's very much a part of my work to be involved in the parish. And so what I do here at the parish is I run youth ministry. I do RCIA. I run CCD classes. I meet with people individually. But then I'm also in charge of missionary volunteers for our community. So that means any young adults that want to serve for a short period of time, whether that's the summer or for an entire year, can come and serve with our community. And so I coordinate that. Yeah, that's a little bit about myself here in Corpus Christi. And so we'll just toss it on over to the novices who are somewhat near where I am. They're about 20-minute drive away. And so they can explain that to you.
I'm Sister Ashley Marie, and we live here in Robstown, Texas, like Sister Caritas said, which is about 20 minutes away from Corpus Christi. So we get to see our sisters and the priests and other people in our community a few times. Not as much right now, you know, but our community is based out of Corpus Christi. So we have a lot of our members down here.
I'm Sister Mary Bridget. I'm from Georgia.
And I'm Sister Mary Megan. I'm from Kansas.
And I'm Sister Mary Rose. I'm from Ohio.
Nice. Thank you, novices. It's so nice to have you here. It's so nice to see you all. So we're going to have Sister Caritas. She's going to share a little bit of a tour of the convent. We did a video of different convents. And so you're going to get to see a little bit of our missionary life, because we're not only here in the United States, but we're in many other countries. And so we're going to show you some of our missions in Belize and Guatemala.
Hola, bienvenido a nuestra casa. Hacia adelante. Entrale. La Sociedad de Nuestra Señora de la Santísima Trinidad le da la cordial más bienvenida a todas las señoritas que deseen visitar nuestro convento en Benque Viejo del Carmen, Belice. Vengan y lo verán.
Welcome to St. Joseph's Convent here in Benque Viejo, Belize. There are four sisters serving here. Hermana María de la Asunción, who has been in our community for 37 years, Sister María of Merciful Love, myself, Sister Mary Rachel, and Sister María Julia. Two of us are perpetually professed sisters. We have a temporary professed sister and a novice. Being that two of our sisters, Sister Asunción and Sister Julia, are from Guatemala, and the other two, Sister Rachel and I, are from Texas, our convent is happily bilingual.
Part of our week together in our schedule, we have only as sisters, and part of our week together we have with the larger community of priests, laity, and volunteers. Every day we gather as sisters for at least one main meal together, and we take turns cooking in the house, which turns out to be quite the adventure with lots of different recipes. We pray together in the house, our daytime prayer, just as sisters, our evening prayer, rosary, liturgy prep, and night prayer. And we also have fun nights, impromptu nights, every so often, where we watch a movie or play Jenga. Our Guatemalan sisters love animal movies and saint movies. And myself and Sister Maria love superhero movies and Kung Fu Panda, so we take turns. A big part of each day is also spent in our individual apostolates. And then with the larger community, we gather every day with the priests, the volunteers, and our laity for Mass and Holy Hour in the morning. And on Wednesday nights, we have family nights, where the Sault Ecclesial Family Team members come over to the convent for dinner and for spiritual exercise and evening prayer. This is one of my personally most favorite parts of the week. On Saturday, we also open up our convent to the larger community for donuts and coffee after Mass and liturgy prep together, where we reflect and share over the Sunday readings. So that is a little snapshot of our weekly schedule here in our convent in Benque.
Due to the needs of our mission, our apostolates are quite spread out. Sister Asuncion is our house servant and also Sister Julia's novice formator. When Sister Asuncion is not having class with Sister Julia, they both visit families in need, especially in Arenal and Cala Creek. Those are the nearby villages. They take clothes, medicine, and food to families that are most in need. Just this week, as they were visiting in Cala Creek, they came across a little girl who had stumbled upon an ant pile. She had bites all the way up to her calf and was struggling to walk because her feet were swollen. The sisters quickly attended to her needs. Most importantly, when they go out to visit, they take the joy and love of Christ with them. Our mission here has 4 primary schools, 1 high school, and 1 junior college. At the primary schools, I help to prepare students to receive sacraments, the sacraments of reconciliation, Holy Eucharist, and confirmation. Due to COVID, students were not able to receive Holy Communion in May, with government restrictions only allowing 10 people gatherings, even for Mass. Every Sunday, 3 students receive their Holy Communion. So during the week, my classes are as small as 1 to 3 students at a time. Sister Mary Rachel is the campus minister at Our Lady of Mount Carmel High School. She has retreats with all the grades and takes them all to Eucharistic Adoration weekly. She also very joyfully has RCA classes with the high school students who feel called to enter into the church. Also due to COVID, her ministry is now virtual.
A big part of our life and apostolates is also the fact that our mission has so many volunteers, American volunteers that come for the year, and also local volunteers. We love our volunteers and feel so blessed to be like big sisters to them in this mission. We serve with them in the apostolate at the high school or in catechesis and sacrament prep at the other schools, and visits to the villages with them as well. We love gathering with them for birthdays and celebrations and meals together. And occasionally, we'll even open up our convent for all-girls movie nights or inviting the girls in for adoration with us in the mornings. At St. Joseph's Convent, serving Our Lady of Mount Carmel Parish, we feel extremely blessed to be able to live our charism in such a vibrant way as disciples of Jesus through Mary, living in Marian Trinitarian Communion, serving on this ecclesial family team in this area of deepest apostolic need. We thank you for the chance to share this snapshot of our life with you, and we ask for your prayers as we continue to imitate Mary, to become like Jesus in living for the triune God.
Okay, so that was a tour of our convent in Belize. A little bit about our life. There's a lot of dimensions there to our community. And so we're happy to share with you a little bit about our charism. And I don't know if Sister Kateri had anything she wanted to add about the charism before we throw it to the novices who are going to share about it.
Well, just one aspect. So they mentioned, one of our parts of our charism is we serve in areas of deepest apostolic need according to the request of the bishop. So whatever mission we're assigned to, our community meets with the bishop to say, okay, what's the greatest need in your area? And so it depends on really what country we're serving in as to what the need is. So that's why some of our apostolates at the missions vary. And so we'll have the novices right now, if you could unmute yourself and you can share a little bit about our charism.
Okay, yeah, that was really beautiful. That was really beautiful. So like the sisters have said, our charism is that we live as disciples of Jesus through Mary, living in Marian Trinitarian communion, serving on ecclesial family teams in areas of deepest apostolic need. Yes, so... and it's this particular gift of the Holy Spirit that has been given to our founders that we are seeking to live out on our journey to heaven and hopefully to bring as many people to heaven as possible. So we live as disciples of Jesus through Mary. We seek to follow Jesus so closely. And to draw others into following him as well. We strive to live as disciples of Jesus by imitating Mary, by becoming more and more like Jesus, and by serving the triune God, by serving the most holy Trinity. And it is in these ways that we seek to grow in Marian Trinitarian communion, which is part of our distinct identity within our charism.
Okay, I'll explain that part. It's kind of a mouthful, so it's easier if we break it up. But the Marian Trinitarian communion part, basically what that means is, if you think about Mary, she had a very special relationship with each person of the Trinity. She's the daughter of the Father, she's the mother of the Son, and she's the spouse of the Holy Spirit. So Mother Mary, more than any other person on earth, has these very deep, intimate relationships with each person of the Holy Trinity. And so we want to live in communion with the Holy Trinity too. So living in Marian Trinitarian communion just basically means that we look to Mary to teach us how to have relationships with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And so in our community, we really try to nurture our relationship with Mary and ask her to lead us into those relationships with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Awesome. And then the next part of our charism is that we serve on ecclesial family teams. So we talked about that a little bit, and you saw in the video, the sisters serving with priests and with lay people, and we have brothers in our community too. Which is just really beautiful. That was one of the first things that struck me about SALT in one of my first encounters with them. So I was in this room with SALT priests and SALT sisters and a SALT family and a SALT, like a single woman who was a volunteer, and just like experiencing like the joy and I don't know, just the beauty of how all the vocations and the charisms that God gives us, they're complementary. It's just a blessing to experience that and to see how God uses our differences and our different gifts to build up his kingdom.
And the last part of our charism is that we serve at areas of deepest apostolic need, which Sister Kateri explained well when she said that we're seeking to meet the needs that the bishop sees in his diocese, needs that aren't being met in that diocese. The bishop invites us in as a society to take care of those. And that looks like, we've said it looks like a variety of different things. And so we serve in rural areas. We serve in different countries. We serve in big cities and then in more poor towns in the United States, in schools and parishes, in children's homes. So it really takes a lot of different forms, but we're always seeking to meet the needs of the church.
Right. Thank you, novices. That was awesome. Now, Sister Caritas is going to share with us another short video of kind of a little sneak peek of all of our missions. So you'll get to see a little bit of a flavor of our community.
Awesome. And as we go through this video, at some points when there's no audio, I might be offering a bit of commentary. And so that'll be my voice that you hear. If there's already people speaking, I won't be adding any commentary. So just kind of, just so you know, but it gives us an image of our missions and where our missions are serving. And so like Sister said, we're in many different facets of ministry. So let me go ahead and share my screen.
It's very necessary for you to have that spirit of saving souls. And if you're going to become a good priest or a good religious, you've got to have the spirit of saving souls.
And when we talk about love, it's not some sort of theoretical concept or precept. It's a reality, it's a person. And he speaks to the depths of who we are. And he comes to us vulnerable and little. And his heart is broken open, wide open, so you and I can come and find rest and healing there. And it is captivating.
So our community serves in the American region. We serve in various places, and one of them outlined is in Belize. This is the main church in Belize in which we serve. This is an image of Sister teaching at a Catholic school. It's one of our priests serving ministry and a sister teaching catechesis. This is Sister Rachel with adoration at the high school. She is filled with zeal to serve the high school students. This is an image of a mission trip that we take every year to Belize. And this is an outdoor excursion with our missionaries. Father is celebrating Mass for them. We have an outdoor excursion for our young college students who are going to school in Belize. We also serve the poor in the area, and we teach at the elementary schools. And so you'll see it's full of joy. Sister Maria is filled with joy as the students come to greet her. I think this is a very common occurrence for her. This is at the church, one of our missions at the church. So it's not the main church, but it's one of the missions. And I think it's in Kala Creek. I could be wrong. And then this is the main church where we have most of the catechesis. Across the border, we serve in Guatemala. In Guatemala, our sisters do something similar where they do catechesis and service to the poor. This is a renewal of vows for the 25th anniversary of two of our sisters. Our sisters come from all over the country. We have sisters from Thailand, Belize, Guatemala, Mexico, United States. We also have a mission in Kansas City, which I'm going to let you guys learn a little bit more about.
The faith is the greatest gift that we can give to our children. And the greatest way to give the faith, knowledge of Him, is through catechesis of the Good Shepherd. It's truly about the relationship. More than anything, we want the children to come to a relationship with Jesus, because otherwise it's all lost. It's all just knowledge. And while it's good to have that knowledge, more importantly, it's to be able to know Christ and to love Him with their hearts, because that's our path to holiness. It's not how much do we know, but how much do we love?
I think something really special about Our Lady's Montessori School is that it's authentic Montessori, you know, steeped in the Montessori method of education, but at the same time, it's authentically Catholic. It's recognizing that God created these children good, and then that they're called to greatness. It's amazing.
I just love the Montessori method because it's this whole freedom for the child to just discover the world and to discover beauty. And for me, that's what Montessori speaks of. It says, things are beautiful, things are good. And as you enter into the classroom, you see that. And so they come into these classrooms already peaceful and ready to work and open and excited about what they're gonna learn.
At Our Lady's Montessori School, we have peace education. We have a peace corner where we go through different emotional development with the child. We help them to learn how to recognize and name different emotions. And then once they've kind of figured out how to name them, we help them learn how to cope with those emotions.
Our Blessed Mother, she was quiet and hidden, yet was a powerful disciple of Jesus. She had that interior strength, and the children, that's what we see in them, is this quiet, this little gem that's just so powerful. It's God is doing amazing things in them, and watching them discover things, it's a beautiful work of God.
Immediately from walking in the doors at Our Lady's Montessori School, you can feel Christ's love. It is everywhere. It's in their philosophy and their mission statement. It's in their teachers and their sisters, and even, you know, our cook here, that we all live and breathe to serve God, and we serve them through the child.
So Our Lady's Montessori School, it's really a home. It's a place where we're all coming together. The staff is a family with the parents together, which is making the Most Holy Trinity be made manifest in their relationships. So one child at a time, one family at a time, we're going out fulfilling the desires of Christ to go and make disciples of the whole world. This is our mission in North Dakota. We serve on a Native American reservation, and it's full of joy. And the ministry we do there is really geared toward the youth and the elderly and obviously the families. So we run a Catholic school there. We have missionary volunteers who serve there. And then we also have a convent that is associated with the mission, which is our convent, which is about 20 minutes away. Super cold there. This is a mass at the nursing home, which our priests go to serve mass at least once a week at the nursing home. This is an image of our missionary volunteers. These are our priests that serve there with the bishop. And we also help serve those who live at the housing projects. And one family we met there was this family named David and Nell. And they were so blessed to receive the sacrament of marriage nearing the end of David's life. He was able to enter into communion with the church right before he passed away into eternal life. So such a blessing. We also serve in Detroit, and that's where Sister Kateri is serving. And such a blessing. She is the principal of the Catholic school that is there. The Catholic school is K through eighth grade. And she does a fabulous job. This is Sister talking to the junior high students at the Catholic school. Many of our sisters serve at this school as well. And then we have Sister Solanas there. She is serving the kindergarten. And we also have our brothers who are studying for the priesthood there as well. So it's a very vibrant ecclesial family team that we serve on in Detroit. That Sister Lauren, she's made her first vows and the parishioners gave her roses in celebration. So we were very honored that she made vows in Detroit. That's the convent reception afterwards and Brother David playing his violin. We also serve in Nuevo Laredo, which is right across the border. And we serve there again in catechesis and evangelization and serving the poor. So that's sister teaching catechesis. That's a large part of what the sisters do there is catechesis. And this is Father getting ready for baptism, which is a big ordeal because it's not just like one baptism, it's numerous baptisms that take place at a time. And so it's just a very joyful mission with a lot of life and growth. But the needs are very large. The parish there, I think, it's over a million parishioners. It's just because it's a very spread out mission. Those are our sisters who serve in Mexico, Guatemala, and Belize. We have a very special mission in Colón, Mexico, where we run a house for the youth and the elderly. And so I will let, there's a little bit of audio here.
What's special about Santa Maria is the opportunity to serve children and to really have an impact on their lives, to form them. You live with them, you're with them all the time, and so you have opportunities to share with them as a parent almost. And our children come from a number of different backgrounds. A number of our kids that come because their families are poor, or at times they come from families that are broken. Just being in an environment that's stable, and they see people in their lives that care about them, that are there all the time. Have that stabilizing presence in their lives of the people that are here all the time, the priests, the sisters, and the lay men and women who are so faithful to serving them and being with them.
We need Santa Maria la Mexicana here in Mexico to share the love of God with the most needy people. And so there are people that come here from broken homes, broken families, and we also work with the elderly who need to know their dignity as well. And they're the ones that need to know that they are beloved in God's eyes. And if they know that, then they can use all the things we wish to teach them here about work, education, the faith. Then they can use it to go forward and to build the kingdom here in this world, but also to prepare themselves for happiness with God, the one who loves them and cares for them.
I think it's just important for people to realize that helping out Santa Maria, you help these children not for just one little bit of their life, one portion of their life, a few days, but you help them for long term. And so helping us financially or helping us by being a volunteer, you're helping us to fulfill that goal, that they're better people, that they serve Mexico, they serve the whole world in a better way, and that they become young men and women that value family and that they find a way to break the cycle that they found in their own families.
So we also have a mission in Iowa, In the mission in Iowa, we have a retreat house and we serve a lot of the lay families in the area. The main ministry is family ministry there. And so there's a lot of joy. A lot of the families come together and just grow in their faith. They'll have women's groups for mothers and men's group for the fathers. And it's just a great place of joy and prayer and serenity. And so people will go out there just for a retreat or a place of rest. We also have missions in Corpus Christi in the southern part of Texas. We serve many parishes here. This is St. Joseph's in Corpus Christi. We also serve Christ the King where I'm serving at. We also have a retreat center at Our Lady of Corpus Christi, do young adult ministries. This is an image of one of our novices for her birthday. This is Robstown. This is where the novices live, our lovely novices that said hi. And then we gather here once a year as a community. So our sisters, our priests, and our lay families come together for a week once a year where we have renewal of vows, where we have teachings, we have a talent show, we have just a good time where we can grow spiritually, grow together, and then be renewed for mission. And so it's just a South Texas is a very vibrant community in the fact that we have so many people here. We also serve in the Asian Pacific region. Most of the pictures you saw were from the American region, but we have about 45 sisters in the Philippines and Thailand together. And then we have about 40 to 50 priests as well who serve in mission. And so if a sister enters with the American region, they would have to request to be assigned to the Asian Pacific region, but it's not uncommon for some of our sisters to visit or to be assigned in another region. And so these are our sisters from the Philippines. And so they're such a blessing. So we get to see some of them every 5 years when we get together for what we call a general assembly, which is a bigger one. This is an image of two of our sisters who had their anniversary for their 50 years of vows. I'm sorry, 25 years, not 50. This is a school that they help at in Thailand. And then we also have a mission in Papua New Guinea. And Papua New Guinea is a blessed place. And we have a sister who is from Papua New Guinea, and her picture will come up soon. But yeah, they do a lot of evangelization there and care for the sick and for those who are in need. So we're so blessed to serve in Papua New Guinea. And this is an image of our assembly in which we gathered. We always take a group picture at the end. So thank you guys for watching that video. I know it was a little bit lengthy. Hopefully it was good. It gives you an image of the places that we're serving as a community. And so if you want to learn more about our community, you can go to, I have the website up right now, SOLT.net. And on this, you can see a few options. You can look for vocations. Sorry, I stopped sharing. Let me just share that real quick one last time. So if you want to see more about our community, you can just go to SOLT.net. And in that, you will see there's a little vocation drop-down section where there's sisters, priests, and brothers you can learn about. Or if you're interested, maybe you're discerning and you want to serve for a summer, you want to serve for just a short period of time just to discern your vocation, you can come to volunteer. And you can look for missionary opportunities. We have a summer camp that we run in the summer, where college-age students or young adults come to serve. And then we also do missionary volunteer work in North Dakota and in Belize. And so that is all I have to share. I don't know if Sister Kateri has anything else to add.
No, you did an excellent job, Sister Caritas. I think we're moving on to question and answer. So we'll have Dawn and
Yes, thank you for sharing. I'm sure there's a lot of new questions that have come up after watching your videos and whatnot. I'll ask an obvious one on behalf of everyone in regards to going on the missions like Asia and Belize and the South American countries. Are you at all invited to consider them, or are you placed there? Does your community send you anywhere at any time? How does that work?
For missions, we're assigned, and that is something that is discerned through our superiors. So they talk to us quite a bit about it. If it's in the American region, oftentimes it's more of like, we're asking you to go here. If it's in another region, that would take a whole level of discernment, you know, where we'd have to be really involved in that discernment to feel like if we wanted to go, if they wanted us to serve in the Philippines, is that something we really feel called to? So it would be more of a collaborative effort.
And do you have to have any college experience, language experience? Do you suggest college experience?
So we usually recommend that someone that's discerning has had that college experience, but it's not always necessary. That's where there is a lot of discernment into joining a community. Usually you will contact our vocation director, and then she kind of walks you through, okay, it's now a good time for you to look into our aspirancy program, or maybe it is, usually we do recommend that you finish college first and then continue on with religious life. But there is a discernment, so it's different for everyone. And for languages, no, you just kind of, sometimes you learn at the mission, so it just depends.
Great. And sorry, I muted the novices just because we were hearing you too. So if you want to unmute yourself to speak, know that you're muted right now. another question in regards to like the status of community that you are, you know, there's a difference between being a religious sister in religious life versus you're a society of apostolic life. Can you describe what that even means? Because you look just like any other religious sister. So is there any canonical or something important that these women should know about?
So a society of apostolic life means that our serving of God comes from our apostolate. And then through the apostolate flows through our prayer life. So in a religious community, it is more the prayer life then flows into the apostolate. So we are both a apostolic and contemplative community. So we both have a balance of prayer and active ministry. But with the Society of Apostolic Life, there is a difference canonically where religious life is in a different category. However, we are, we're still sisters. We still take vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience. But our ministry really usually is the main focus. However, in a way, if you came to visit, you really wouldn't see too much of a difference because we do pray the Liturgy of the Hours. We pray the Rosary every day. So we have a similar prayer life, but our main, focus would be the missions to be able to bring Jesus to the people that we serve in the mission and through that, draw them to prayer. I don't know, Sister Caritas, if you want to add anything to that.
Yeah, that was perfect. And two, just our status gives us a little more freedom in terms of like mission work and serving God's people. Whereas Sister Kateri mentioned it, you know, like for those in religious order, it's the order that sanctifies them. Whereas for us in the Society of Apostolic Life, it is the mission that can be what sanctifies us. And so, but that doesn't mean we forsake our prayer life. We just have a very heart for being a missionary community, and being a Society of Apostolic Life gives us that freedom to serve those most in need.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. So we're kind of coming to the end of our time for questions. Just really quickly, the Paschal, so we have a poll coming up here and we want the ladies to fill out the poll. But what is a Paschal retreat? Would you mind just mentioning what that is briefly? Somebody asked that as a discerner.
So we, every weekend, one of our sisters is on what we call the Paschal Mystery Retreat. So a Sault sister every weekend is praying, and we're all assigned a different weekend throughout the year. And what it is we pray through the Paschal Mystery. So Thursday night, we pray on the Last Supper and going into the agony in the garden. And then we pray Friday on the mystery of our Lord's passion and death. And then we wait with him on Saturday, and then we celebrate the resurrection. And so it's a silent retreat that we go on, assigned once a year, that each sister takes to really unite ourselves with our spouse.
Nice. I like that. So we got this poll up here, and I'm sure you're all able to see it. Are we closing it, Rhonda, or are we just gonna let it go a little bit longer? I can't hear you because you're muted.
And make sure you go ahead and vote, everybody. We want everybody voted. And then we'll end the polling, and then we need to have that time of reflection and prayer. Okay. 70.
And remember, for those of you who are saying yes, you would like to know more about these sisters, make a note of that, because in our discernment hour, you're welcome to go into their community's breakout room. So remember that as we go along. Okay. Thank you, everyone, for taking this poll. If you're discerning out there, would you like to know more about the Society of Our Lady of the Most Holy Trinity? And 54% said yes, and 47% said no, thank you. And are you just curious about the convent life? Did you find you're more interested in this now that you were experiencing their community? 72% said yes, that this is helpful for them to be able to see and experience your community this way. So thank you, everyone. And thank you, sisters. Thank you, all the Sault sisters, Sister Caritas, Sister Kateri. So nice to see you. The novices. We'll see at least one or two of you back this evening, right? For the breakout discerner session. So thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm gonna pray for you guys. God bless.
Thank you. So at this time, everyone, we have a little over 10 minutes before our next session. Within this 10 minutes, we're going to actually do just a little reflection to take in what we just experienced. Sometimes we just like breeze through things in life, and we don't want us to do that. We want us to actually take a moment. There's going to be 5 communities total. So this is going to be a moment to just have reflection time. If you have your journals available, just like to ask you to have your journal handy if you have one nearby, and just take a moment to just quiet yourself. And we're just gonna invite the Lord just for about 5 minutes to show us anything that he wants to about the experience we just had with the Sault community. So I'm just going to give you some walkthrough of a couple questions, and you can ignore me if you are like on a roll with a thought. Just keep, you know, writing in your journal or just ponder a minute. But we just invite the Lord to just kind of help us go back through the scenes of the seeing the sisters in prayer, seeing their apostolate. If there's anything in particular that struck you about their apostolate, such a focus on their mission life in their sanctification, God sanctifying them through their missions. Maybe just ponder if there's anything about missionary life that's exciting you in your heart, especially going overseas, being sent to a new place, new people. If there's anything that struck you about that, maybe it struck you in a challenging way. So like, oh, I don't know if I can be sent overseas like that. I mean, that's really good to note. So we want you to just kind of think through the honesty of your heart, what God might be revealing to you about your experience with this community. And about their particular way of living out their charism in the world, where they go to the place of most greatest need, the bishops send them, ask them to be taking on certain apostolates. Is that resonating with your heart? Working alongside volunteers, associates, religious brothers and priests of their community in this unique city? That they have all these other people involved in their life. So sisters are placed right where their priests are. That's a uniqueness about this community. Is that attractive to you? Is that not? These are just some kind of things to help you take in your community, this experience. And is there anything about the community itself, seeing the joy of the sisters, or anything that struck you about just seeing their life together in a challenging way, in a joyful, I'd like to go experience their actual community way? That's good to note too. And maybe just in this last quiet moment, just for one more minute, just invite the Lord, if there's anything else that he wants to show you about this community. Sometimes you see the community and you're like, wow, I'm so glad I experienced their community, but it doesn't feel like home, or it does feel like home, or I had a sad feeling, or it's good to kind of just let yourself be honest with the experience that you just had with the community. So just give yourself an extra minute and then we'll let you go off for a bathroom break. Thank you, Holy Spirit. If there's any more insights that you want us to have throughout this day, continue to bless us. Whenever you guys are ready, feel free to take a bathroom break and please return just a tad before the top of the hour. So we have about 6 minutes.